me dancing in the background, I know, but that's okay. Welcome. Tonight, we will be talking about something that's very important to many of you. We will be talking about Alzheimer's Disease Awareness Month. But before we get to that, oh, happy Thanksgiving to everyone. We are not live this evening because we are home enjoying Thanksgiving with our families. At least I am. I hope you are enjoying Thanksgiving. But if you do have a question or a suggestion for a future topic, you can always email me anytime, day or night, at talk@bcattv.org, because I love getting email, and I love getting email that is not spam. So thank you to my 178 likes on my BCAT webpage, so thank you very much. Hope you enjoy the show. I do want to go through some administrative tasks. I want to thank the crew here this evening. We have Kyle and Corey, who are staff members here, and they keep the show running smoothly and make sure that everything's put together so I do not have to go in a panic mode. I would also like to thank Colleen Moore, my director extraordinaire. We were having a discussion earlier about do we use last names, do we not use last names? So Colleen, you get both. I would also like to thank Maddie Shipka for coming in and doing camera and helping me through this. And there's one other person whose name I totally forgot, but thank you, Tatiana. Thank you, Tatiana. Hope you're enjoying the cookies. So even though I forgot your name, you get an extra cookie for that. And last, I would like to thank my husband, Paul, for staying home for daddy date night, hoping the children are not still bouncing off the walls. And I hope you have a lovely evening. So now I think all of my administrative duties are out of the way, and I can welcome my lovely guests who came all the way from Watertown.
Yes,
so we have, and I need my cheat sheet again, we have Christine and Susan.
What?
Christine and Susan.
Yep, got
okay.
It.
Yes, we need name tags. So thank you very much. I know that Alzheimer's disease is very significant. Well, I don't want to use significant, mm-hmm. but I know that it's, you know, very debilitating. It's very hard on families. It's not just, it's kind of like a spider web. Everybody seems to be affected by it. So we will talk about that in a little more detail later. But first I want to, you know, everybody at home has heard me before. They know all about me, but we don't know about you. So you guys get to take your pick who wants to go first. Right. But can you tell me a little bit about yourselves, where you grew up, where you went to school, how you became involved in working with Alzheimer's Association?
Want me to start?
Sure.
Sure.
Start.
Okay. So I grew up in New Jersey, and I actually became interested in working with older adults as a general population in my undergrad studies. And I went on to get my master's in social work. And at that point, was actually volunteering at the Alzheimer's Association New York City chapter in more of a development capacity, but definitely aware of the organization during my time in New York and during my graduate school studies. So I was working in a healthcare environment before coming to the association just about a year ago. And I.
So you've been with Alzheimer's Association for a year?
About a year, yeah. Just last winter started.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you, yes. And I manage our 24/7 helpline at the Alzheimer's Association.
Okay, so you moved from development, which is more of the fundraising stuff, to.
Customer service helpline type. Yeah, when I was, the development piece was more when I was volunteering at the Alzheimer's Association in New York. So doing thank you calls and just sort of familiarizing myself with the great work that they were doing there.
Okay.
And then got my master's in social work, and that sort of transitioned into a bit more of the role I'm doing now, which is more
now,
the program side.
How did you manage to work your way from New Jersey, New York, up
sure.
to Boston?
I went to my undergrad. I went to Holy Cross, which is in Worcester.
Oh, okay.
So I had sort of half my friends in Boston, half my friends in New York.
Okay.
I knew after grad school I'd be ready for a smaller city, so made the move to Boston after
New
that.
New York's a little intimidating.
Yeah.
I'm intimidated by New York. I know some people
are. It's a wonderful place to visit, in my opinion.
It is. But actually, my niece and nephew live there now. So
yeah, it's a great place.
More power to you.
Exactly. Boston's good.
I like Boston.
Yeah, me too.
Okay. Susan, you're up.
So, well, I'm a Massachusetts girl. I grew up in Westboro, Massachusetts, and my journey's a little bit different. I ended up working, well, I was a psychology major when I graduated college.
I was a psych major, too.
There you go. This is why we get along.
Exactly.
So, I wasn't sure what I wanted to do. I had all sorts of aspirations of being a psychologist and different kinds of things, but I always felt sort of a kinship with an older population. Hmm. So I ended up working as a social worker in a nursing home, a licensed social worker, and it ended up just sort of being a calling for me, and I found myself naturally gravitating toward individuals with Alzheimer's disease, other types of dementia.
Okay.
So I worked for about 25 years as a licensed social worker in Mass, working mostly in nursing homes, assisted living. And honestly, the Alzheimer's Association was always on my wish list.
Really?
I was very proud of the work that I did in long-term care, but honestly, the people that I could serve were the people in the building that I worked with.
Oh, okay.
And after doing that work for a long time, I learned a tremendous amount from the families, from the individuals who lived there, from the other staff. But I always wanted the opportunity to be able to work more broadly and hopefully to make an impact in other ways. So I was very fortunate and actually worked in our New Hampshire office of the Alzheimer's Association as we opened up that office. And now I work out of our Watertown office. I've been with us for about 7 years, and I'm Vice President of Programs and Services with the association.
Now, does the Watertown branch cover Massachusetts, the greater Boston area? How is that kind of regionalized?
Yeah, we're a two-state chapter, so we are actually the Massachusetts-New Hampshire chapter, and Watertown is our home office.
Okay.
So that's where most of our staff are, but we have regional offices so that we can reach all the corners of our chapter. We have an office in Bedford, New Hampshire, but we also have offices in Raynham, Worcester, and Springfield, Massachusetts.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And we don't have office space in the Northeast, but we have a concentration in the Northeast, Merrimack Valley, North Shore area as well.
All right. Now, November is Alzheimer's Disease Awareness Month. Why do we need to have an awareness month?
Well, I think there is, you know, this is, for lack of a better term, almost an ascending disease. I think Alzheimer's disease is more recognized now than ever before, and sadly, because we have more and more people developing this disease.
Okay.
And as you began our conversation, it's an extremely complicated disease process. It not only impacts the individual profoundly, but it certainly impacts their family as well.
Okay.
And Alzheimer's Disease Awareness Month gives us an opportunity to really kind of shine a light on the challenges that individuals and their families face, but I think it also shines a light on our opportunity to be a part of really, you know, creating a movement that will ultimately bring an end to the disease.
Okay. Tangent number one. How do you envision going about raising awareness? Is it like through education? Is it through fundraising initiatives? Is it through special events? Do you have plans, and if so,
oh, we're all about plans. It's sort of all of the above. You know, it's a multifaceted approach, and you know, we there are a number of different ways that we bring awareness to this disease. So I think Christine can speak to our programs and services, but in a moment. But I'll mention that we do a tremendous amount around helping the general public to understand Alzheimer's disease. And, you know, quite unfortunately, whether you have a personal connection or not, it impacts all of us. This is a disease that currently affects over 5 million Americans. The trajectory of that disease is going to triple in size within the next couple of decades.
Really? Do you think it's because, like, the baby boomers are, like, living longer?
Absolutely.
Or, you know, the life expectancy used to be 78, and now it's, like, 96 or something?
Yeah, you know, there are many risk factors for Alzheimer's disease, but the greatest risk factor is age. The older you get, the greater the odds are of developing the disease. So as the baby boomers are now, for the last couple of years, they've entered enter that age of risk mm-hmm. that we associate, which is 65 and older. So this is a healthcare epidemic that is really growing in a tremendous way. Okay. So with that, we really want to capture the public's attention to that disease. And okay. So we have a variety of different ways. We do fundraising and public awareness events. The event that most people are familiar with is the Walk to End Alzheimer's Disease.
Is that like the same thing as the Memory Walk? Or is that something different?
Years ago it was called Memory Walk, yes. Okay. And you know, we made a very strategic decision to call it. No. that's fine. It's a good opportunity, though, for us to talk about our shift in the way that we are becoming much more assertive in attacking this disease. And we made the conscious decision to call this what it is, which is the Walk to End Alzheimer's. And we focus on helping families right here, right now, who are living with the disease, which I'm sure we'll be talking about in some depth. But we're also not messing around. We're in this to end this disease.
We're serious.
we're in it to win it, as they say. And we are fiercely dedicated to advancing research so that, no question about it, we need to bring an end to this disease.
Now, when is the walk?
Well, we
just finished.
Darn! Have to have you on
next year. Sure.
But how would somebody go about finding out? You know, in the past, I've had people from the Relay for Life for American Cancer Society on, and it's like you have to have a team for that. Do you need teams to participate in this? Do you have to fundraise, or is it, you know? Just like an entry fee type thing? How is it organized?
You can join as an individual or you can join as a team. A lot of times people will join as a group and then sort of get other people around you involved. And it's a nice way, again, to spread awareness by getting other individuals you work with, family members also involved and join in with the fundraising. But you can certainly join as an individual too.
Okay.
And online, call us on the helpline and we can help direct you to
get
involved in the walk too, So,
and whether you want to walk, do you try finding volunteers to help with, you know, handing out the water or
these are really volunteer-driven events. We absolutely could not do it without the volunteers. And it's a very invigorating, empowering experience. Mm-hmm. The volunteers are incredibly passionate, enthusiastic, and it's so much fun to work with them. This is their event. You know, we're sort of more of a background player and support them. This is really driven by very strong volunteer committees.
Excellent.
And we're very proud of their work, and we just kind of give them what they need and set them off and they do a phenomenal job.
Now, is it a national event or and if it isn't you're nodding saying yes, it's national.
Yeah, it is.
Does everybody have them at the same time or are some in June and some in September and how does that work?
They're all around it's about a four-week, Susan, period that the walks throughout the country?
Yeah, for the most part. Yeah. There are some that extend a little bit further into November. It does depend seasonally.
You don't want to walk outside right now.
Not in Massachusetts or New Hampshire.
No.
You do not. So ours happen to be
earlier.
Ours are the last two weekends of September. We have 11 walks throughout Massachusetts and New Hampshire.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. And to answer one question that you mentioned too, there is no minimum entrance fee. You know, this really is about raising awareness, and yes, it's about raising funds. So we do hope people will fundraise, but quite frankly, we just want people to come and be a part of the experience and to enjoy themselves and be a part of raising awareness.
We'll walk, get t-shirt.
Yeah.
There you go. I'm in it for the t-shirt. So I think you kind of mentioned this earlier. How many people are afflicted with Alzheimer's? Is that like the correct terminology?
I myself tend to say living with Alzheimer's disease.
Okay.
So currently we have about 120,000 people in Massachusetts living with Alzheimer's disease, about 5 million in the United States.
And that's mostly like ages 65 and older? Mostly?
Mostly, yes. And, you know, the face of Alzheimer's disease, I think we're understanding more and more. Mm-hmm. And absolutely, the greatest risk factor is age. But unfortunately, younger people can develop the disease as well. Mm-hmm. You can be in your 50s, 40s, even 30s.
Wow.
Extraordinarily rare.
Okay.
But it can occur at a younger age.
Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not super familiar with the disease itself. Mm-hmm. I'm just aware that there's something out there that affects memory called Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when I'm at the mall, I forget where I parked my car. So do I have to be concerned that I might be coming down without, you know, what's normal or acceptable memory loss and forgetfulness versus, oh no, I need to talk to my primary care physician and start researching because I might be coming down with Alzheimer's. Does that make sense?
Sure,
it's a great question.
It's a great question. And I think a piece of it that can sort of transition from that idea of misplacing your car keys or forgetting where you parked is sort of a more persistent or consistent issue with your memory. Okay. You know, you might forget someone's name and then recall it, or you're in the parking lot and you're not sure, and then you're able to find
the keys.
It. Right,
yeah.
Right. But I think when you start to notice changes that are impacting your function in everyday life, so it's something that you're consistently needing reminders that you might not have needed before, and you're noticing that you're requiring those things to get through the day more consistently.
Okay. Now, would you recognize this in yourself, or is it like others pointing it out to you?
I think it can be a combination of both, I would say. I think sometimes there's some insight, and maybe with that, if you're noticing it in yourself.
Because I'm also thinking sometimes there's like denial.
Defense, sure.
Okay. Like,
of course. And I think sometimes there's a combination of both. It might be that, you know, someone may point it out or notice it in themselves, and then families will sort of agree with that as well. But I think I would say a combination of the two, for sure.
I think you're right about that. And, you know, what's important and what we always urge anyone who has concern about, is this something I should worry about or not, to go to the doctor. And we realize that this is scary. This is not an easy thing. But it's important to recognize that there are many things that can cause some of the symptoms that the person is experiencing.
Okay.
It certainly may not be Alzheimer's disease or another type of dementia.
Could be like a vitamin deficiency.
Absolutely. You could have a thyroid problem that's not being treated. You could have some kind of medications that are interacting with one another. There are a number of different reasons. So if we can identify what it is and treat it and reverse it, then
you
that's
reverse
incredibly.
It?
If it is not a progressive disease process, sure. We may be able to identify something and treat that, and the person can regain their abilities. But, you know, even in the worst case scenario, if it seems that this is not something that we can treat and it looks like it could likely be Alzheimer's disease, it's incredibly important that the person has the opportunity to really take control of their life, really, and to learn about the disease and to develop the opportunity to figure out, you know, what are the coping skills that I want to think about here, and what do I want to communicate to my family? And this is an opportunity to really be empowered and not just be a victim to the disease.
Now, I'm just, you know, thinking, if I were afflicted with Alzheimer's, you know, if I was diagnosed with Alzheimer's, is it normally like the same progression, or does it hit people, some people really fast and others it could take years and they could, you know, use some of the coping mechanisms for a long time? Has there been any research done on that?
I would leave the research part to you, Susan, if you have any information on that. But I would say, too, a part of that might depend on also when someone receives a diagnosis. I think Susan made the point that it can be scary, and like anything else that we might notice or have a little bit of insight into ourselves, going to the doctor and looking into something can be a frightening thing to do. Yeah. So sometimes people will receive a diagnosis after the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease or another form of dementia have been presenting themselves for a long time.
Okay. And that if I don't go to the doctor, I don't have it.
Right, like anything else. And I think that that can sometimes lead to the progression seeming more quickly progressing.
Yeah.
Because you were diagnosed a bit later as things have progressed already.
Okay.
But I think, as Susan said too, the importance of finding out what's going on mm-hmm. early can be empowering okay. so that you have a say and involvement in mm-hmm. what's going to happen as things progress or how you want to be involved as things progress.
Okay. And, you know, I think also when we think about Alzheimer's disease, there is sort of a general progression that we expect. It does okay. tend to begin in a certain way.
Almost like stages, but the stages can be months
yeah,
or the, years.
There are certain symptoms okay. that tend to present a little bit earlier than others, and it okay. tends to have some common progression. But, you know, truly every individual mm-hmm. is unique. And you know, as Christine very importantly pointed out, some of this depends upon when are we detecting this, okay. But also what are your other existing health mm-hmm. issues that may impact the progression of the disease. There are a number of factors. And we're also, you know, we're talking about Alzheimer's disease. There are also many other types of dementia. Alzheimer's disease is one type of dementia. There are others. There's vascular dementia, which is a series of small okay. strokes or blood clots on the brain. Okay. There's Lewy body dementia. There's frontal temporal dementia, all different kinds.
Wow.
And they progress a little bit differently. Okay. So if you were to look at someone with Alzheimer's disease versus someone with vascular dementia, okay. the progression is not exactly the same. Okay. And it really is toward, you know, the latter stages of these diseases where it tends to look a little bit more, you know, consistently, you know, similar, but the way that they progress is variable.
Hmm. Okay. Good.
Good questions, Linda.
How is it? Is there a blood test, or how is it tested to find out whether it's Alzheimer's or some of these other dementias, or is it just like, not hearsay, but just kind like, yeah. you know, more subjective?
Mm. There's a fair amount of testing usually that will go into looking okay. more into a diagnosis. Oftentimes they're done by specialists or diagnostic clinics to get into the real thorough diagnostic evaluation to see okay. what's going on. Like Susan was saying, to see if there's other medical conditions that might be causing the okay. confusion or memory loss that someone's experiencing. Oftentimes a first step might be to look at things like a vitamin deficiency, like you okay. said, or a nutritional deficit. A blood test to see if there's an infection or something else that okay. might be contributing. And then from there, you know, might be more of that sort of pen and paper
okay.
interview.
Kind
and
of rule out.
Really
the,
teasing out, yeah, right, okay. and specialists that can go through sort of an interview process to see and tease out where an individual's deficits may lie so that they okay. can see more definitively which diagnosis seems to fit with the issues they're presenting with. And sometimes that also requires a scan of some sort, too, to okay. take a look at what might be going on organically in the brain, too.
Okay. So, like, you know, I'm just trying to think of what kind of specialist you'd see. Would like a logical progression be like a neurologist or?
Sure, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think there are generally three areas that we take a look at. And as Christine mentioned, you know, it begins with a good thorough physical mm-hmm. and checkup, if you will, with your primary care physician okay. so that we can rule out things like, you know, vitamin yeah. deficiencies and so forth. A neurological assessment is also another important part. Okay. So again, that's sort of taking a look at how the brain works. And, you know, typically in a neurological assessment, the neurologist is taking a look at coordination and reflexes and how the brain is talking to the body and things mm-hmm. of that nature. And often within that examination, that's typically when a brain scan is ordered, some kind of picture of the brain. There are different kinds of brain scans, and that's driven by whether or not the person has had a scan before, what the neurologist would okay. recommend. And then often a psychiatric assessment is highly valuable. Okay. So again, we can flush out things like, could this be depression? Could this be anxiety? Could this be other kinds of issues?
Okay.
And really the combination of those three perspectives along with that brain scan gives us the most information about the brain.
Okay.
And then it's really monitoring over time and watching for changes that helps us to really sharpen our diagnosis, if you will. this area, you can imagine, is complicated. This is a complicated process, and we always urge families to absolutely call the Alzheimer's Association. We have our 800 number, or they can go to our website, and we're happy to walk them through the process and to help to know what kind of doctor should I be looking for, what should I be asking for. This is exactly what
or
we're
what
here
should
to
I
help
be asking?
With. No, exactly, yeah. Exactly.
You
know, so we are very happy, and Christine and her team are our full clinical team works with families every day through this process, and it's one of the things that we have a lot of experience with, so we're happy to help.
Now, you had mentioned that typically Alzheimer's affects people of age 65 and older, typically. Has research shown any other, I don't know if target audience is the right word, but is there like a hereditary component or a genetic component or like an ethnic component or, you know? Or
sure. There are populations that are at higher risk. We do know, for example, the African-American population is one that it tends to be at higher risk, for example. And you know, really what we take a look at are a number of different things that help us to take a look at trends and things of that nature. But when it gets down to the question of is this hereditary or not, the vast majority of time it is not. About roughly 95% of the cases of people with Alzheimer's disease develop Alzheimer's disease for reasons other than genetics. And we're still figuring out why it's happening, and there are different theories and things out there. There is a very small percentage that carry a gene that is linked to Alzheimer's disease, and tends to be the younger onset
type of
dementia. Yeah, you know, it's again extremely rare, but that tends to be a population that seems to have more of a genetic link than the older, comparatively speaking. But this is a white hot area of research, is taking a look at these very issues, and we know more now than we did, you know, 10, 15 years ago. It's amazing how far research has advanced in our understanding these pieces. Excellent. But this is white hot area right now.
Exciting. Never a dull moment at the Alzheimer's Association.
That's true.
Now, listen, my place. We've talked about, you were just mentioning genetic. Are there other risk factors that have been noted or noticed?
Yeah, it's interesting. I'll explain it in a ridiculously simplistic way, but when you think about it, the brain is attached to your body, correct?
In most cases. There are some times where that's questionable.
So with that, it stands to reason that if you take care of your body, you're also taking care of your brain. Now, you can do everything right and still develop Alzheimer's disease.
Right.
There's no way to guarantee you can prevent it. Just as you can do everything right and develop cancer, you can do everything right and develop heart disease. But the odds are, if you were doing more things right, you're putting your body and your brain in a better position. And we do know through research, backing up common sense, mom was right. If you eat your vegetables, if you engage in physical activity, if you don't engage in risky behavior, then the odds are that you are minimizing your odds of developing Alzheimer's disease and other types of dementia. But even in the worst case scenario, if you develop Alzheimer's disease, a healthier person managing that disease is in somewhat of a better position than someone who has a very complicated medical history. So again, you can do everything right, but you are putting yourself in a good position if you take care of yourself. And the easiest rule of thumb that we recommend is a heart-healthy lifestyle contributes to a brain healthy lifestyle.
I thought you were just going to say listen to mom.
Yeah, that too. Mom is always right. But you know, when you think about, a lot of us know a lot about a good heart healthy lifestyle, even if you don't have heart disease. We know the good foods.
Right.
We know how to keep physically active. So if you apply that, the odds are you're putting yourself in a good position.
If you apply that, it's
up to you.
Application part.
Sorry. Darn, I shouldn't have gone, you know, to fast food today. Okay, now we touched upon this a little bit, but generally, what is the life expectancy of someone once they've been diagnosed? Granted, I know it depends on but does it, have you noticed, or not you personally, but does it shorten your life expectancy when you are diagnosed with Alzheimer's?
It's a fatal disease. Mm-hmm. It is a fatal disease. And this isn't meant to sound rude. This is the question I like the least because it's really difficult to answer. But it's a good question. It's a fair question.
No.
You know, statistically, the range that you tend to read is 3 to 20 years. And how helpful is that?
Sure.
That really doesn't help.
You know, when I'm 7 years old, 20 years is fine
with
me, you know?
But, you know, I think the important thing, and it's not to sound depressing, but this is a fatal disease. This is the brain that is dying,
at the moment.
That's a good point.
At the
so
moment.
So important for us to jump on this and advance research.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, my next question, looking at my cheat sheet, is how does this affect the brain? Is it just a memory loss, or are there other criteria or other issues that are developed? I'm not quite sure what I'm trying, you know. Is it just a memory thing, or is there more involved?
Sure. And usually, a lot of times, a common symptom that sends people to look towards a diagnosis is the memory loss component of it.
Okay.
And having short-term memory deficits or issues remembering new things or learning new things and retaining new information is typically a symptom that will present itself commonly in Alzheimer's disease and be one of the things that sends people looking towards a diagnosis. But as things progress and those issues become greater, that can also start to impact a lot of other things. And as the disease progresses, you know, the impact that has on the brain can start to impact things like your impulse control, your processing. It can, you know, much further along in the disease, impact things like your ability to walk and really.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was getting
at, and,
you know.
Yeah, the whole, like Susan pointed out, your brain is attached to your body and it works in such complex ways to help us do things that we do every day. So as, you know, the disease progresses and those issues and areas deteriorate, it impacts all parts of the body. But initially, I would say more the symptoms of memory
loss.
That's
kind of like the red flag that goes up is, you know.
I think it's the symptom we most hear about. Most
and
of us
most
know that's kind of what
with.
Catches you off guard. And, you know, but also we can find symptoms such as just being able to sort of organize your thoughts a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we were sharing that you're a mom, I'm a mom, and you know how it is when you get home and you're making dinner. You don't have to really plan it out. You know what to do. You know to get out the box of rice and put the water in the pan and put it on the stove, and you open the fridge and you get out the chicken, and you know the drill, and you're on automatic pilot. But imagine if you don't know how to organize your thoughts. You don't know how to get started. What comes first? What comes second? So something that used to be very familiar to you, making dinner, becomes very complicated because you just don't know where to start.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes a sort of a warning sign that maybe this is getting difficult for the person is someone who ordinarily would make themselves dinner every night is now eating a bag of chips or opening a container of ice cream. One step, easy, done.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's a change.
I kind of like that menu.
I know, that might not be a change for some of us, but
if
you're finding that there are changes in the person's everyday routine, we want to figure out, well, what does that mean?
Mm-hmm.
Does
okay.
it mean Alzheimer's disease? We don't know, not necessarily, but it's something to explore.
Something's worth seeking medical attention.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, how are families you know, we've talked a lot about the individual mm-hmm. being impacted. How are families generally impacted, and what can families do to help? And I know I'm asking a bunch of questions mm-hmm. here, and support systems.
Good questions.
And, yeah. You know, it's not just the individual, it's a bigger picture. How do you address the bigger picture?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the caregivers, especially, you know, we encourage and welcome and want the individuals that are living with Alzheimer's disease to be involved. But I would say a large number of the individuals that we are serving through our programs and services and on the helpline are the family members that you're mm-hmm. talking about, the caregivers. And I say caregivers too, because I think sometimes people will minimize the care that they're providing, but you know, long distance coordination of things, helping around the house, everything like that is really providing care. Mm-hmm. So we like to empower people to honor and own that role, because okay. there's a lot of work that goes into helping someone that is living with Alzheimer's disease.
And
another
it's not
form
just
of
how to make dinner, it's how to sure. you know, pay your bills and right. all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And
I think as
plan for the future.
Sure. And I think as Susan said too, it's those simple things that yeah. you know, it's helping people learn a new way of communicating mm-hmm. or a new way of helping.
Right.
So how can you set up the day for success together? And that might mean simplifying some things that before were just naturally happened, or you just...
Now, would checklists generally help? Like, to make dinner, you know, open up
fruit? Sure. I think, you know, and with mild Alzheimer's and other forms mm-hmm. of memory loss, when you're having mild symptoms of that, checklists and reminders can be incredibly helpful. And
those
also
little voice recorders on your kitchen.
Right,
you
yeah.
parked your car. And,
and it's sort of a trial and error. What works for the individual? Everyone learns differently at baseline and mm-hmm. you know, responds better to certain reminders and things like that. But okay. certainly, and I think the more that you can do to involve and engage the individual that's living okay. with Alzheimer's disease or another form of dementia, all the better to keep them involved and work with them rather than around them.
I think one of the tricky things about being a caregiver is the fact that the disease does not remain constant. Mm. This is a progressive disease. Right. It has a beginning, and you know, often a question that we have people ask is, did somebody know they have Alzheimer's mm. disease? And now our society in general has more awareness of what Alzheimer's is, and whether or not someone seeks a thorough diagnostic workup, the odds are, you know, they're talking to their doctor at least mm-hmm. in some form, and there is some awareness and insight. But for the family's experience, you know, they feel like, okay, we have some ideas on how to support, let's say if it's mom, and we've kind of got this down, and okay, we're good to go. And for a period of time, it can be very helpful, but then something changes. Mm-hmm. And therefore, again, you're having to think, oh, yeah. okay, now how do we adjust here? Right. So it's a complicated experience for the individual, it's a complicated experience for the caregiver, and it's always changing, and it always requires how do I adjust, and how do I think ahead, and how okay. do I minimize a crisis? And
can you anticipate in like the progression of the disease? Mm. Like if you are, you know, planning ahead, what will I do, or what to expect so I could start thinking about it yeah. now? Is there kind of like that normal progression?
Yeah, well, I think...
Or normal enough that you
yeah,
can...
Yeah, there's a lot that we know about the progression of the disease. And I think the way that you're articulating it is great, Linda, because it speaks to the fact that, yes, it is unique for every individual. Mm-hmm. But honestly, this is where we would like to come in, because we work with so many families. Over mm-hmm. the past year, we have received over 10,000 calls on our helpline alone.
Wow.
Just here in Massachusetts and New okay. Hampshire. And what that speaks to is we have a lot of working practice, if you will, with families. Okay. And with that, we're able to help families to think about, okay, here's the dilemma that you're in right now. Let's figure out how to manage this. Okay. And then let's think about, you know, what maybe you want to put on your radar screen mm-hmm. so that we can start thinking about this okay. now to minimize something getting very complicated, or hopefully to minimize a crisis as well.
Right. And, I mean, you don't want to get blindsided. And
right. Sure. Right. And I think that's where, you know, part of some of the services that we can offer through the Alzheimer's Association, one being the helpline, is checking in with people. Things, as Susan said, will progress, and we can be there sort of along the way to be a helpful check-in.
So do you reach out to people, or do you wait for them to call you?
So we, our initial contact is encouraged for individuals to call our 24/7 helpline anytime, 24/7, as the name implies. And then from there, we're fortunate at our Massachusetts and New Hampshire chapter to have a wonderful and robust group of volunteers on our helpline. And the volunteers, along with our clinical staff, work towards following up with people as well. Part of that too, as we know the disease will progress and that things may come up and change, it's wonderful that we have the opportunity through that follow-up program to really be able to check in with people and see, you know, hopefully work with them to plan ahead. So check in and see, is something changing slightly? Have questions come up? Are things changing? And then we can guide them towards guidance with our staff, a program that might be helpful for them that might not have been as relevant, you know, 6 months before. But guiding people towards those things, and really, as Susan said too, thinking about them ahead of time. You know, the more you can plan ahead, better to have those things in your mind and working towards ahead of time, sort of in your back pocket.
Exactly.
So you have them when you need them versus planning around a crisis, because it's unpredictable when things can change.
And additionally, we have other services as well. And for example, and you know, families don't have to worry about what service should I ask for. Just call us and we'll help to figure out how can how can we be of support. But just to share that we're able to sit down with families. They can either come to one of our offices, or many families like to meet with us over the phone so that they don't have to worry about providing care for a loved one and they don't have to travel. But with that, we sit down and really talk about what are your unique family circumstances. We provide education about the disease, help them with problem solving, symptom management, here are resources in your community, here's how you figure out what's the best match for you. All of this planning we're able to do. And also we offer a wide range of education programs all throughout our two-state chapter. And education programs are phenomenal, in my mind, for two reasons. One is that you're getting critical information that really can help you to figure, oh, okay, I'm getting a handle on this now. But equally important, in my mind, is that you're there with other families who are experiencing a very similar situation. And this is perhaps one of the most isolating experiences someone can go through. You can't help but feel all alone when you're overwhelmed with this disease process. And over and over and over again, we hear from families, the most empowering experience is to be able to connect with another family who happens to be walking in your shoes as well. So these services are available. And by the way, all of our services come at no cost to families.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
and
that's
all
excellent.
All that they have to do is call our helpline or go on our website, and then we can work with them from there. And you know, we barely scratch the surface for the services that we provide, but they're there, and we're eager to work with families throughout this journey, really.
Because while you were talking, I'm sitting here thinking, you know, it's probably not a fair comparison, but it keeps, you know, when my child was first born, I felt very isolated and routines were constantly changing and I needed help, but I just couldn't pick up the phone.
Sure.
So that's why I'm thinking that's great. You know, I think that's really impressive that you're able to contact them, because they're probably, you know, drowning but can't
take that next step.
Take
maybe.
That next step. So when somebody calls and says, hey, do you need some help? Yes, I do. You know, so that's amazing. And then I'm also thinking, you know, feeling really isolated, talk to other families who have gone through that. Oh yeah, my mother put the banana in the toaster yesterday. Oh yeah, my mom did the same thing, you know. So I'm just, that's got to be, you know, so you don't feel so isolated. And then you have that support system because your family may or may not be supportive of you, but, you know, having others that have experienced it must be relieving.
You know, sure. You feel a little bit of strength and empowerment mm-hmm. with that. And there are also online education programs. Okay. We have chat rooms online, and you know, everyone has a different way.
And
we all have different ways of coping and feeling comfortable. So so there's a wide range of resources available.
Okay. Now, earlier in our conversation, I think you had mentioned that in some cases, the disease can actually be reversed.
So I may have misspoke.
I probably misheard.
So I think what I was referencing is that sometimes people can have memory loss or confusion or something doesn't feel quite right cognitively, and it may be that there is a cause for that we can identify and treat and reverse.
Okay.
So for example, if someone has fluid on the brain, normal pressure hydrocephalus, if there's fluid buildup and we can identify that early enough, mm-hmm. then that may be able to be treated, the fluid can be alleviated, and the person can regain. So sometimes there are causes of cognitive problems that are for other reasons that can be treated and therefore reversed.
But it's not
Unfortunately,
Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's disease and other types of dementia is something that we can't slow down effectively, we can't reverse, we can't stop it. These are progressive diseases, and once they're there, today.
So there's like, it's not treated with medication or anything, it's like?
There are some medications approved by the FDA that are designed to help. Honestly, the effects for most are somewhat modest, and really what the medications are designed to do is to be able to help the brain cells to be able to communicate with one another a little bit longer.
Fire those synapses.
Yeah, to be a bit more effective. But you know where we're headed, if I can jump to that, with medications is actually incredibly exciting. So I let me preface by saying I am not a researcher or a clinician. But to speak very simplistically to where we are in research today, we have a couple of very exciting things happen. So number one, we are developing, I'm involved, but the research community
you
is...
You are Alzheimer's Association.
Not at all. But there is a tremendous amount of advancement in technology for being able to diagnose people much earlier on. And so, for example, there are people participating in clinical studies right now who, through these studies, were able to determine that this person may be predisposed to Alzheimer's disease by using what we call biomarkers, so blood tests, spinal fluid, things like that. Let me be clear to say you cannot walk into the doctor's office today and say, give me one of those blood tests. It's not available yet.
Okay.
But through clinical trials, these are the things that are being tested, and we're on the threshold of being able to identify who may be predisposed to the disease.
Okay.
The other incredibly exciting thing is that the medications that are currently in the pipeline, if you will, also in clinical trials, are a very different kind of medication than what's available to us today.
Okay.
And these medications are designed to sort of flush out and regulate the buildup of a protein in the brain that causes problems associated with Alzheimer's disease. So when you put those ideas together, if you can figure out who is predisposed to developing Alzheimer's disease and proactively give them a medication that will flush out and regulate the buildup of the plaque that develops, you are preventing the damage from occurring. Are you curing the disease? Not really, but you are preventing the symptoms from developing.
So it's a more proactive approach than a reactive
approach in the
pipeline.
It is, and this was, you know, science fiction a handful of years ago.
Absolutely.
We're on the threshold of that. What's stopping us is money to advance research.
Okay.
What's stopping us is more people being involved in clinical trials.
Okay.
We are right there. We are right on the threshold. And this is why we're passionate about advancing research, because will we cure Alzheimer's disease in our lifetime? We don't know. Can we achieve this profound breakthrough in our lifetime? Mm-hmm. We are very, very close. And to put a time frame to that is impossible, but we need to be assertive and aggressive about popping that over the threshold, because it will make an impact on millions of lives if we can make that
absolutely.
Happen.
Oh, absolutely.
Can you tell this is important, the way we talk about it?
Okay. Tangent again. You mentioned clinical trials within the United States and FDA approval. How is it globally? Do you work with other international organizations? Is it still called Alzheimer's Association or Alzheimer's disease somewhere else?
Yeah, the Alzheimer's disease is a global leader in advancing research, and one of the reasons is opening up avenues of communication so that entities that were doing research that used to be competitive with one another, now we're bringing them together.
Okay.
So we have international conferences, for example, where we're bringing the top of the top researchers worldwide to come together, and this is an invigorating experience for them.
Oh, yeah.
Imagine being part of those who will find the cure. So this is an exciting race. And the clinical and research community absolutely understands that working on this collaboratively is key and is what will accelerate this effort. So worldwide, this is a worldwide effort. But here in our nation and locally, we have a program where families can learn more about research studies and clinical trials, trial match. Yep. And Christine always speaks to this better than I do, so I'm going to put you on the spot. Yes, I'm tagging you in.
If somebody wanted to, now, with some of these research studies, you said it's more of a proactive, prevent it from actually happening to begin with. Now, if someone wanted to participate in the study,
was a great segue,
what are you
Linda. That was perfect.
What are you looking for? I mean, if you already have Alzheimer's, does it rule you out or?
So there are clinical trials that are going on for individuals that are living with Alzheimer's disease and other forms of dementia, and for those that are not. So I think it's about a third of the studies in this area, at least, or at least in our Massachusetts, New Hampshire chapter, that are looking for healthy volunteers. So someone that is not showing signs or symptoms or has a diagnosis. Okay. And we have a program called Trial Match through the Alzheimer's Association that does just that.
Is there like an age?
There may be in terms of what studies that are actually going on.
Okay.
But Trial Match is a program that we have that you can go online or sign up on the phone, or we have brochures that you can fill out in paper too. There's many different ways to get involved. But there's a way to provide your information, your age, where you live, if you do have a diagnosis or a healthy volunteer, and that information you'll send into Trial Match, and then they will match you with a trial. You're not obligated to participate, but it will give you information about trials that are going on in your area that if you're interested, you could participate in based on, the demographics or other information that you provided. And a piece of that, too, can just be learning more about what research is going on in the local area as well. Okay. So, again, no obligation to participate, but if there's an interest in research, it's a great way to find out what's going on.
And not all studies are related to medications. I think the general public has an understanding.
Yeah.
So there are some definitely that are related to medications, but there are others talking about lifestyle choices and caregiver stress and driving, all different topics. Mm-hmm. So to Christine's point, Trial Match is a great way to learn about what's out there, and it does not obligate you in any way. And if you want to have sort of the up-to-date information on what's the latest that's happening, it's a perfect vehicle to find that out.
Wow.
Yeah. We're actually signing up for Trial Match.
We should have brought Linda one to sign up too.
Yeah. I don't think you'd want, tape electrodes to my head. No. Now, I think we talked about a lot of the support systems and the safety services and everything. We also talked about, all of the services that you provide are free. Do you envision, here I go with my yes-no question that I swore that I wouldn't do, with all of the changes occurring in healthcare, do you anticipate that affecting the treatment or the diagnosis of Alzheimer's Do you see that changing at all, or do you see it remaining the same, or?
I think the piece that we can speak to probably that might have an impact, and also based on sort of what we've been talking about today about finding out early, is just a movement towards a bit more of preventative care and, okay. and wellness checks, for example, and having that closer relationship with your provider to, if you are checking in more regularly
okay.
and are being alerted to changes perhaps more regularly in that dialogue with your provider, okay. you know, that can be a great way to pick up on changes versus having a less you know, communicative or regular
okay.
visit with mm-hmm. a with a medical provider, mm-hmm. I would say is a change I could see coming.
Yeah. Okay. Now we are getting close to being out of time, so hopefully I could get these next questions mm-hmm. in. It's going, you know, backing up and moving mm-hmm. in a different direction. How would, if a loved one was affected by Alzheimer's mm-hmm. disease, if you cared for them at home and realized that the stresses were too much, what is your advice for someone to start looking at alternatives, like either an assisted living mm-hmm. facility or a nursing home or, you know, professional home health aides
sure.
coming in? What is your advice? How would someone get started mm-hmm. on that mm-hmm. road?
So I think one way they could get started, of course, is calling us on the helpline.
Number.
and I say that as being one of our helpline staff that's speaking with families, in that those are great questions and things to start thinking about, and that's based on what the individual is going through, what the caregiver is going through. We can talk through, you know, what might look like a good plan to get started on.
Okay.
And it depends on so many different factors in terms of how long someone can safely remain at home, you know, when is that sort of tipping point that it's becoming unsafe for the individual with Alzheimer's disease, but also for the caregiver. As things progress, it's a 24/7, more than a 24/7 mm-hmm. job. And, you know, based on what resources people have at home, and resources meaning so many different things, you know, other family involvement,
right, okay.
you know, financial ability to perhaps bring in help and assistance, what community resources are there available, really can make the difference in terms of, you know, when that tipping point might present itself.
Okay.
And I think it's very important to recognize that the Alzheimer's Association does not make referrals to specific organizations.
Mm.
We have a very rich database that does share with you all of the resources available, but we are not in the position of saying you should choose one over the other, because there are so many variables.
Okay.
But also it allows us to maintain our independence and not to be swayed in a way that's mm-hmm. not helpful for
a
family.
You need to remain objective.
We do,
sure.
we do.
Yep.
So
right.
our focus is to educate families. So we have some phenomenal guides that you can actually bring with you, and these are the questions that we would recommend to help you determine, is this the right match for you,
okay.
along with talking with our staff and our volunteers on the helpline to help gauge, how do I evaluate this? How do I figure out if this is the right match for my needs?
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Now, we had mentioned the services, we mentioned the research, we mentioned the walk.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any other fundraisers coming up? If someone wanted to make a donation, could they do that? And
you can do that year round. Certainly, we would never say no. But there are a wide range. The Walk to End Alzheimer's is our largest annual public
okay.
awareness and fundraising event, but there are many, many different events. So in addition to fundraising events, we also have educational programs. So
okay.
we just had, for example, a research event that was free to the community, and we're continually doing larger events such as that as well. So again, not to keep doing the helpline, but honestly,
helpline.
That is the best way to find out what is in your community, what are you interested in, what's
it's
of interest.
It's the starting
point. So it is. It's sort of the portal to all of these different services
right.
and events.
Well, we are out of time, so I can't talk. Definitely want to thank both of you ladies for coming out on this frigid night. And I do hope you have a very happy Thanksgiving. And
thank
I did
you.
Learn a lot, so
you
thank
too.
You for enlightening me. And yeah.
Thank you.
Thank
we
you.
Appreciate the
and
opportunity.
And I also want to thank
you
everyone
too.
At home for watching. And I hope you have a very safe and happy Thanksgiving. And welcome to the fun holiday season. And I will see you around town. Have a great night. Good night.
bubbles.